Recently, This Is America and the World visited the Sultanate of Oman in the Middle East. Oman borders on Yemen, Saudi Arabia, and the United Arab Emirates. Qatar and Iran are also in the neighborhood. Oman is a safe country at peace with its neighbors and itself. Oman should be on your list of places to visit. While other countries may offer skyscrapers and nightlife, Oman offers serenity and calm. Take a tour or rent a car and drive the country on some of the best roads in the world. Experience spectacular mountains, historic sites, an overnight stay in the desert, and of course, the sea. This Is America visits Oman. This Is America and the World is brought to you by Japan, history, hospitality, and advanced technology, sharing tomorrow. The Republic of Haiti. The League of Arab States. The Sultanate of Oman. The Rotondaro Family Trust. The Forerunner Foundation, dedicated to forward-thinking public policy. And the Embassy Series, uniting people through musical diplomacy, presenting international artists in diplomatic settings. Every Friday morning, the town of Nizwa is alive with energy. It's a time and a place for locals to come together to socialize, do some business, and buy for themselves and their families. For tourists, watch the goat auction, sample a never-ending variety of dates, or indulge yourself and buy a souvenir. A local resident told me about Nizwa.
This is very exciting.
Yes, it
is. What happened? What's going on right now?
Actually, this is the market of Nizwa, where all this is like a social gathering rather than a market, where everybody is, participating in every Friday morning. So you will see the elderly, the youngest, the desert people coming, or the ladies from the whole over Oman, to participate in selling their goats and their cows and the livestock, where they like trading in. They sell and also they buy.
So this is like a auction, huh?
Yes, it is an auction actually. And it is done weekly in every Friday morning. The market here, from all over Oman, they come from Bahla, from Nizwa, from Izki, all the surrounding, cities. They come here where they have to enjoy maybe for at least 4 hours before the Friday prayer.
You mentioned Nizwa.
Yes.
Tell me about Nizwa.
Nizwa is the most historical city in Oman, and it was for decades, in the golden years, it was the capital of Oman, historically. And later on, it was, of course, being shifted to Muscat.
Now, here we're seeing the auction.
Yes.
But if we go inside, paint a picture of what we'll see inside.
Yes. You will see, actually, in the market here, the dates market. You will see the fish market, the meat market, the grocery market. And also, you will see the most traditional Omani sweet, which is called Omani halwa.
Halwa.
Halwa. That's the most, Omani traditional sweet in whole of Oman. And in Nizwa, that's the most, favorite Omani sweet factory.
It surprises a lot of people that in a market on a Friday, at an auction, people are dressed in the traditional dress of Oman.
Yes, because we are proud here that to wear the Omani tradition. We cannot wear anything else because we've been, grown up with it, and His Majesty always, directive that to keep the Omani preserve and the customs. This is generation from generation to generation. This is widespread, here in Oman, that we are to keep it, as it is, because this is traditionally and also from Islamic perspective. from Islamic, it is tradition. I mean, it is modest, for especially for ladies or gentlemen, to keep it that way. So it is, I mean, whether it is, I mean, from Islamic or from traditional, it is all together, combined together, which makes the Omani identity. I would like that Omani to keep their, I mean, identity, I mean, the years to come, in order to keep it that way. We are to teach our youngest to keep the tradition, and also, I mean, to in Islamic way, always. We keep it in Islamic way and in Omani way combined together, because that is the right way and the correct one.
Thank you so much your hospitality and for the education.
Thank you.
And celebrating this wonderful day with me.
Thank you. And you are welcome, because it is our national day, the 48th national day.
Yes.
So you are in the occasion of the 48th national day of Oman. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You can't even start the half-hour drive up Green Mountain without passing a checkpoint that confirms you're operating a four-wheel drive vehicle. The mountain is a maze of switchbacks that exposes some of the most breathtaking scenery in the world. At the top of the mountain, and you wonder how it was ever built, is perhaps the most celebrated hotel and resort in the Middle East. I spoke with the manager.
Well, the hotel opened 2 years ago. We are now in the third year of operation. It took a few years to build it up in the mountains. You can imagine, logistically, quite an undertaking,
yes.
Including infrastructure. I guess the street leading up to the mountain was not always there as well, and a few years.
The building of the hotel at the top of this mountain, probably 5,000, 6,000 feet up in the air, it must have been a nightmare. Well, I should say, it must have been a challenge to bring up the materials up the mountain to build this beautiful, beautiful hotel.
I prefer the challenge one, you know, but it was a true challenge. Not only getting really everything up here, also the trucks could only be loaded half weight, so it took a little longer to get everything up to speed to construct properly.
Tell me a little bit about the hotel, the number of rooms, the guests, the services that you offer.
Yes, we have altogether 115 rooms split up in partially beautiful canyon view rooms and villas. Guest segmentation very, very different depending on the season.
Mm-hmm.
You see, right now we are actually in our high season from October to April, very much attracting the international community. Most of them there coming from the European background, some from the US as well, but still mainly European focused. And during the summer season, we are far more working with our neighboring countries, because for the GCC clients or guests, I should say,
in the near area,
especially UAE, the weather conditions are so much nicer up here, and we are far more than working with those guests. Weekends are fully booked, and throughout the week as well, because it's really high season.
Wow.
And I usually say it's my substitute community, because I have the UK travelers, the German-speaking market, some French, some Italians, you know.
We gotta get Americans coming over here, huh?
True. They start discovering the beauty of the country.
Oman is so peaceful, huh?
Oman is totally different, and I may say, but now I'm really talking as somebody who stepped in from Lebanon, which is also Middle East, and as the Lebanese have a total different culture,
mm-hmm.
very European, Arabic mix, but more related to Europe, whilst Oman, again, Middle East, but it's so different,
yeah.
It's so authentic, it is so genuine. And also the vision of the Sultan in developing the country, it's such an organic, healthy, almost slow growth, but in a very subtle way, whilst maintaining really the culture, the look and feel of the country, despite the Omanis being extremely friendly and hospitable. So you have a total different approach actually here to the entire scenery and culture versus what we live sometimes in the GCC. It's a different approach of development. I would definitely say it's the most beautiful workplace on earth. It's the highest work place I've ever had. It's an office on top of the mountains, and I am, I guess, with the team, the way they are, on top of the world. I would again emphasize the love that I developed here for the beauty of nature. You become very humble up here. I have been a little bit around in business, in the retail, in hospitality. And you know, luxury hospitality has also the red carpet approach, the grand hotel approach. And I find this hotel out of this world because it is luxury, it is mountain lifestyle. Yet, very humble, very discreet, and nature.
Thank you so much for
this. Thank you very much for taking the opportunity
to speak
to you.
And that was a wonderful answer.
Thank you very much. Wonderful.
Terrific.
Thank you.
Oman's history is that of a seafaring nation. Its location on the Arabian Gulf has always been a natural for trade, exploration, and transportation. One of the most recognizable symbols of Oman is a boat or ship called the dhow. Built by hand and made from wood, the dhow is still used today for fishing. I talked with a former commander in the Oman Navy.
So the origin of the biggest tribe in Sur, which is Al-Janaba, historically they were a Bedouin tribe, came to this area 400 years back and dealt directly with the sea.
That's quite a transition though, from a Bedouin tribal people coming into this area and then all of a sudden learning how to build ships. How did they learn?
Actually, the poor environment in Oman and the situation, the critical situation, that time after the Portuguese had left the area, did not give them any other choice. So straight on from the mid of the desert into this area, their leaders decided to transform this tribe from Bedouin into a mariners.
Do you say dhow or dough?
It's dhow. The dhow word actually is coming from Africa, and the European normally when they mention the dhow, they meant any Arab wooden ship, but it's not the true actually.
Okay.
Yeah.
Help me understand.
No, it's okay. The true is there are so many different kinds of ships. The biggest one. The Suri biggest one is called Al Ghinja. We have got one sample of it in Sur. It's one of the medium one which is left, and the last one, and it took something around 350 to 400 tons cargo, and you cannot compare it to this one because this one are just fishing vessels. They are very small, but the huge ones. They were called Ghinja. It's similar in shape to the caravan Portuguese ship.
Ah, yeah. How many people could fit on one of the big ships?
Well, the crew were up to 35.
35 crew?
35, yeah.
And if they were transporting people, say, from Oman to East Africa, how many people would go on?
Normally, they took it in actually rough circumstances. Therefore, they accept a lot of people.
But how many?
Around 80, something,
okay.
80, 90,
okay.
Not more than that, because you have to also give them some places to rest.
And how long would the trip from Oman to East Africa take?
Varies, because
depends
on the wind, actually, and the sail, but normally up to 23 days.
23?
Yes.
And it was all sail in those days?
Yeah, it was all sail. And as I told you, although the Arab got influenced by the Portuguese ship builders, but the main sail of Arabs, the what they call it, the Latin sail or the Arab sail, remains the same, which is the triangle sail, when the European used the square sail, which is different characteristics. Uh-huh. This triangle sail need to, because it gathers a huge amount of wind, but need a lot of, you know, power to control it. Mm-hmm. Very, quite dangerous. But it's give you a lot of opportunity also.
The ships that we're in front of right now, yeah, are they used just for fishing nowadays?
Yes, this one are for fishing, but in the last 10 years, some traders from North Gulf, like Qatar and Kuwait, they buy these ships and retransfer them into small yachts.
Small yachts?
Yeah.
Ah.
Wooden yachts.
Everything is wood here?
Yeah, everything is.
How long would it take to build this ship?
Like this one, from 6 to 9 months.
6 to 9 months?
Yeah.
So everybody here, they're working in wood, they're artists.
No, yeah, they're,
artists, actually, not actually just ship builders.
No. I mean, if we see the other ships, you will see the difference, because in the big ships, they were really art, and they are doing it without any designing, without any paper. They're just from their own mind.
Yeah.
I mean, when they put the ship into the sea, the water line into the sea, they just put it in, I mean, it gets into the water line. It's amazing, actually. Uh-huh. Without even, they don't know anything about engineering, real engineering, and you know, designing, but they do it perfectly. We are in the last place in Oman. We are making the wooden shipbuilding. Other places, they are using other new material.
Ah.
So this is because...
Why is it disappearing?
Disappeared because of the old ships. They used to be built from teak wood. Mm-hmm. Teak wood, very expensive. And they got it in the last from, in the past from India. Now India has abandoned this trade. They don't export it anymore. Mm-hmm. Therefore, they had to to use other kind of lower quality
mm-hmm.
Ships. Also, the modern stuff has comes into this trade, like engine. So a lot of sailors has just removed.
Is there new industry here in Sur?
There are in the industrial area, but it doesn't belong to shipbuilding.
Doesn't belong to shipbuilding. So that is slowly
disappearing,
fading into the past. Thank you so much conversation
welcome.
For the history lesson.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
One of the slogans used by Oman's Ministry of Tourism is, "Beauty is Oman's address." Travelers and tourists are discovering Oman, and Oman's tourism sector is growing upwards to almost 15% a year. Tourism is now an important contributor to Oman's positive image and reputation throughout the world. I had the opportunity to visit with the Undersecretary of Tourism.
People look at a map and they see Middle East. They don't particularly see Gulf, they see Middle East. And they see conflict and war and famine in Yemen, problems with Saudi Arabia, blockade against Qatar. And they say, they said to me, is it going to be safe there? Is it going to be safe you're going to Oman? How do you respond to that?
Actually, we receive that comment a lot. I think it's in a day-to-day, we've seen that. And due to where we're located with the geopolitics which we have around us, and this is one of our challenges, we've been not only maybe in tourism sector, but other areas.
Sure.
However, looking into, it's been with the competitiveness report from the, we received that Oman is the safest country. And it's very safe.
Mm-hmm.
We never had any issues ever marked in Oman, not only so people are, it's always safe even for anybody to drive around, and we try to promote that. And we've always been the peace people, like we never had any conflicts with anyone. And it's a country where now we see even the youth and the tourists, and looking into the competitiveness report in the world record, they've already put Oman one of the safest countries, the five top, and it's been there consistently the last few years.
Mm-hmm.
So I believe this is already, and things like how we're marketing ourselves, and I believe
these kind of interviews or even showcasing Oman, it definitely guarantees that this is a very peaceful and safe country. And we never had any stories to tell apart of that, that it's a very peaceful and safe country.
How do you go about selling Oman as a tourist destination?
Is one of our objectives for Minister of Tourism is definitely, yes, we promote Oman as a destination, but we have other goals and objective, like we have to really create sustainable projects, and we are really managing the sustainability of our project, creating jobs as well for Omanis and bringing that platform as an increased platform. Mm-hmm. But promoting the destination, we are known by nature and you know Oman, and it's globally, maybe a lot of people they come and ask sometimes, we haven't had the secret of the beauty of the country. Mm-hmm. The last few years we had a very clear strategy. We have representative offices globally. At the moment we have 14 international offices which are presenting the tourism as a sector, and we do a lot. We actually participate in the global exhibitions in different segment. What we are focusing at, if it's to do with the leisure, to do with the MICE, which is a meeting and incentive conferences, because we have created now a state of art exhibition center in Oman. And this is where the areas we're looking into, the markets which we are targeting. And actually, we have different communication, like we do either by communicating by media, the newspapers, or some of, actually we have a lot of footage been printed in Oman in terms of marketing globally. A lot of people have maybe defined Oman as a pricey destination. Mm-hmm. And I think that because we have a nature of a five-star, I always say we have a nature of a five-star, so you can't put anything less than five-star.
On the nature.
Yeah, on a nature of it. But we have definitely catered different markets, different products. At the moment, we do have things starting from a one-star hotels to five-star. Uh-huh. And we created a new products, namely like the heritage homes.
What's
yes,
that?
Those are like the old villages what we have in historical areas, where we have now worked with the communities for sustainable projects, where we've developed them to become an attraction for tourists. And as well, they're small, like what we can name it, bed and breakfast. So they're actually homes where tourists can spend a few days and experience the authentic of Arabia and the real heritage of and the stories of Oman.
Peaceful, safe, and incredibly friendly, huh?
It's these people.
Unique country, huh?
It is indeed.
Excellency, thank you so much for your hospitality. Our rearranging of your entire office
to
sit down and do this interview.
It's great to have you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Special thanks to the Grand Hyatt Hotel, the Crown Plaza, the Arabian Oryx Camp, the Anantara Al Jabal Al Akhdar Resort, and Oman Air. For information about This is America and the World, visit our website, thisisamerica.net, or our YouTube channel, This is America TV, and follow us on Facebook and Twitter. You can listen to all of our ambassador interviews on our podcast, The Ambassador Series. It's available on our website and iTunes. This is America and the World is brought to you by Japan, history, hospitality, and advanced technology, sharing tomorrow. The Republic of Haiti. The League of Arab States. The Sultanate of Oman. The Rotondaro Family Trust. The Forerunner Foundation, dedicated to forward-thinking public policy. And the Embassy Series, uniting people through musical diplomacy, presenting international artists in diplomatic settings.